So thank you very much for coming. I will present now the attack on intercoms. My name is Dudek Sébastien. I'm working for the Synactive company. I'm interested in radio communication things like Wi-Fi, RFID, and so on, networking, web, line security, you know, a lot of stuff. At Synactive, we're doing red team tests. It includes spear phishing, remotes, and physical intrusions. Speaking about physical intrusions, the real deal is that we always need a way to enter to a building for sometimes. So how can we do it? We can do lockpicking tricks, radio frequency attacks, or maybe attacking the intercom. Because as you probably know, the intercom gives you the access to go to the building, and how you can type a passcode, you can present an RFID card, or maybe you can call residents that will answer to the call and open the door. But nowadays, we saw that in new buildings and renewed buildings, there is a new kind of intercoms that were installed. And what we saw is that these intercoms are able to call a resident on the mobile phone. And these intercoms call the resident with a mobile prefix. That means that the intercom is using a SIM card somewhere. So we were very interested about that. And by curiosity, I've just tried to call directly the intercoms to see if something happens. And I was like, OK, I will try it. But the intercom didn't answer. So I was like, OK, what can we do? We can dump and modify the flash, but imagine that we have to do it in front of every people in the street. It'd be a little bit weird. So what we done is maybe to think about another attack which could be done, and we thought about mobile attack. So we studied the intercom for that, but I will present now the intercom. So intercom, dual phone, awesome, call it as you want. It's a voice communication system within a building, and it allowed a visitor to call a resident, and the resident will open the door for you. The term numeric refers to generally to intercoms that are connected to the mobile network using a SIM or USIM card. Different types of intercom exist. You have old one, like conventional one. Conventional one are old intercoms that have a wire for each resident. And with numeric intercom, you don't need a wire to link every resident to the intercom. So it's a little bit much easier to install an intercom, and the wires are replaced with GSM, 3G, and 4G, and other technology. Here is a simplified architecture of the numeric intercoms. So as you can see, I'm a visitor. I want to open the door. What I'm doing, I'm calling with the intercom, so I'm pushing the button to call a resident. The resident will see the calling in his mobile phone. Then the resident will answer to the call, push the button to open the door, and after that, the door will be open. And all of this is made with the mobile network. You have also another architecture, which is installed in most buildings, in much bigger buildings, because here in the simple architecture, the resident phone can update also, sends commands to the intercom. And in this architecture, the resident doesn't care about sending commands to update the intercom, update the number which have to be called. So an administrator can update the numbers using just a centralized server, a website, for example. So you just have to log in, and after that, update the number with that website. And after that, you have a cron, just a cron task that will send the commands to the intercom, concerned intercoms to be updated. In France, you have, I don't know how is it in other country, but in France, we have four brands that are well known, like Comilit, Intratone, Noralce, Euromed Captive, that cost almost like €2,000, sometimes more. For our first test, we choose the Linkcom, because the Linkcom is very is commonly used in private residents, and in the 15th district of Paris, I saw a lot of Linkom device. So that was a very for us. It was a very interesting choice to do. The question is when you go into the street, is how I can spot this kind of intercom, because yeah, there are also a conventional one and a numeric one. So we don't know actually how to spot it. Maybe spotting a nice LCD screen or a new steel case, but it's like, no, not very relevant. But if you're lucky, you can find a very beautiful 3G module in the circle. And this 3G module has, that depends, but sometimes it has three LEDs, and the LEDs indicate the level of the network signal. So that could be a very, very good heuristic to see if the intercom is maybe numeric or conventional. So why I'm here? Publication about intercom are nearly non-existent. So the only publication you can see about numeric intercom is how to build this kind of intercom. But as we know, this intercom use the GSM, 3G, or 4G network. So we thought about maybe merge all the papers, all the researches about the mobile attacks, and merging them, we use also the tools which are now very affordable, like the hardware part and the software part, which is free. And after that, we made a lab that we will see after. Another thing which is very interesting in GSM and GPRS, it's is not new, is that the GSM and GPRS doesn't do mutual notification. So if I want to do some interception, I can, for example, make a rock bus station, and the mobile phone will not be aware if he's in the rock bus station or not, because it doesn't do authentication of the network. Only the network is doing the authentication about the client. So it's a good thing for an attacker. Another good thing is that, as you probably know, is that the mobile phone is always looking for the better reception. So if he sees that the other BTS is sending a stronger signal, it will automatically hand over to the new. It's an interesting fact for the attacker too. So just to resume, GSM and GPRS, with GSM and GPRS, the interception is possible. We can do fake rogue BTS. We can also break the conversation you're reusing, sorry, my French is going on. Reusing the authentication triplets. Also, another fact is that in GSM and GPRS, the signal channel is not encrypted. So if SMS commands are sent by the intercom or any mobile phone, you can also intercept it if the mobile phone use this signal channel. But sometimes the mobile phones can also choose to allocate a traffic channel to send SMSs, like the calls, for example. But normally, a lot of times, they use the signal channel just like that, because it's much simpler. The main differences now with 3G and 4G is that this kind of attacks I've been talking about are not possible, because in 3G and 4G, you have mutual authentication, you have signal integrity, you have a better encryption, so it's very difficult to break this kind of technology. But there is some attacks that could be done on that, like for 3G and 4G downgrades to 2G. You can do that with protocol attacks, but protocol attacks are more baseband specifics, because if you find a protocol attack on a baseband, possibly in iPhone, for example, it will not be the same for an Android phone like a Nexus, for example. So it's time-consuming, it's difficult, and for us, it's not interesting. So the better way is to do jamming attacks, which consists just of sending simple, like, Gaussian noise on the targeted channel. Like, for example, I'm sending random Gaussian noise on the 3G channels that are used by your mobile phone in a specific place. So just to resume how to do it, jamming is very, very basic. For example, in the left, you have a GSM channel, which is, you can see the beginning of the channel. And on the right, when I'm doing, while I'm doing the jamming attack, I'm flooding with random noise the channel, so no mobile phone can see this channel at this time. So it will search for another channel, and if, for example, I'm jamming all 3G channels I can find in a specific place, the GSM will be looking at 3G, it will not see the 3G, so it will automatically fall back to 2G. And one documentation also is clear when I was looking for intercoms. An intercom documentation specified that if the 3G is unreachable, the intercom will automatically use the 2G. So for us, it's very interesting. Let's see a little demo about that. Okay. PLC, jamming. Oop. Okay, so now I'm doing calling, and as you can see here, there is a 3G icon while I'm calling. And now you see that I'm using the RF to perform jamming on two channels that the mobile phone is trying to reach. Here is my schemat of GNU Radio. Maybe you have heard about GNU Radio because there was a workshop about that or so, one day before, I don't know. And while I'm performing the jamming, you can see that something changed because I'm still calling the answer call, and you can see that you can see that the 3G icon disappeared. So that kind of attack works. I could fall back the 3G communication to 2G, and I'd be able to perform my interception with that. And another thing, which is interesting, is that in Nexus phones and in the Nexus 5 and Nexus 6, there is a strange behavior because if you're doing jamming attack, the phone will fall back in 2G for an hour, even if you reboot the phone. It's like very strange. So when you're doing the jamming attack, you can jam the phone. After that, you can stop it and run your BTS very easily. The phone will just stay at 2G, but I only tested it in Nexus 5, Nexus 6. But it's with basebands, we have a lot of strange behaviors, and it's a part of it. Okay, so now we know everything about GSM, the attacks that could be made. Now we have to build a GSM lab. For that, we use a very cheap Blade RF that costs like €370 and some antennas. The software part is free. And with that setup, we are able to connect intercoms, mobile phones, and everything that use GSM, that has a GSM stack. And so for the intercom, we look at the manual to set up the intercom. We see that there is three ways to set up the intercom. The way that is very interesting for us is the SMS one, because the first thing is that you think about, if I know the mobile number, can I send an SMS command to maybe update the number? So it was our first thought, but we quickly saw that it wasn't possible because we thought about these things, because first administrator number, admin one, has to be set up first, and if the administrator, any administrator is, if the mobile phone, the mobile number that is sending the SMS is not part of administrator number, it will not be able to update the intercom. So our first impression was we have to impersonate a number, find a way to bypass it, and that way we can maybe send commands. And what we saw also is that we have an acknowledgement that told us that the command succeed if if we could perform it. So for example, if I want to write to update the number of the resident one, for example, write with the command write habitual one and the number of the resident, the intercom reply to me with write habitual one, okay, the command succeed. So it's a very good authentication while attacking this intercom. So now let's think like an attacker, and we are in an attacker place. So we don't know the mobile operator, we don't know anything about that, the intercom's number. The commands can be found in public or with leaked documentation or performing the firmware analysis, like you can buy it in a shop and try to perform a firmware analysis on these things. So the steps are the following. For if I want to open the door, I have to recognize the intercoms operator to trap it. Once it's done, when it's trapped, I have to leak or guess the numbers of the residents. After that, I register myself, my SIM card, in the rack bus station, because I control everything in my BTS. I register my phone as a leaked resident number. I call myself, pushing the button of the intercom, and after that, I'm able to open the door. So, in practice, it looks like this. I brute force the four MNC that we have in France, like Free, Orange, Bouygues Telecom, SFR, and I waited for 15 minutes to be sure that it be trapped by my rack bus station. I had also to send I had also to have a strong GSM signal to be sure that no other base station will be able to connect to it to be seen by the intercom, because I want the intercom to think that I'm the closest base station. After that, when I trap the intercom, I just had to push the button, intercept the calls, and I succeed. And when you intercept the calls, you can use the Wireshark tool after enable the GSM typing feature in Yet BTS. And with that, I don't know if I can see, we can see that very well, but in the call setup, frame, you can see a field that is called called party BCD number, which is the resident number we're trying to call while pushing the button. So with that, we have leaked one number. And so once we have done that, we're replacing the number of the resident affecting it to our IMSI, our SIM card. And after that, we are able to open the door. I will show it in a demo. If we are able to leak the admin number, we also are able to send commands if we know the commands also. So the most important commands are the read command, the write command to update the numbers of the residents. There is also another command that enable you to communicate with the baseband directly with the call 80 command through SMSs. It is very crazy, isn't it? When you are able to get the admin number and to impersonate it in your work bus station, you can do anything you want and also talk to the baseband. So let's see a little demo about that. Demo. Okay. Up. This is my setup. As you can see, there is a Linkcom IDP GSM device. There is my attacker's mobile phone just in the top. You can see also the antennas, the BLEDRs, and the computer. And what I'm doing is, I'm in a case that's where the intercom is trapped on the rock bus station. I'm doing a first call to leak the resident number after pushing the button. And as you can see, now I'm looking for the call setup frame that is sended. And as you can see here, I can grab the BCD number, which is the residence number that is called with by the intercom. After that, with my computer, I will now update the TMC table to associate my SIM card to the resident number, like that. And you see now that I'm pushing now the button and the phone which didn't ring before will ring because I associated the number of my AMC to the resident number. And now I'm able to open the door and also talk to the visitor who is visiting me. So with that, I'm able to impersonate a number. And if you have the administration number, that means that you can also update numbers. And if you want to earn some money, you can also update the number with an AlloPass number or Optelo iPay and so on. So this is also a funny way to earn some money with your hack. Now let's speak about the interesting part, which is the new part of my talk. It's about the intercom using the M2M machine-to-machine cards. So intercoms that are installed in new buildings provides a SIM card which has 10 years, maybe more than 10 years subscription. It's written in the manual. It uses by default the EMTS network, so by default we will be thinking about downgrade the 3G signal to the 2G. But there is something much interesting because you can manage the intercom with a centralized server. That means you can manage it with a website. There is a website, you know, when you log in, and after that you can manage the intercom. So this is a very new, very interesting vector of attack. There's another vector of attack because they give you, they provide you a SIM, a USIM M2M card. So if you're taking the card and putting in the phone and doing some tethering stuff to perform some scan, you can maybe find other vulnerability in the network of the, or in the virtual network of the intercom producer. And that's very interesting also. So let's just speak for the moment about website vulnerability. So what kind of vulnerability you can find? There's plenty of, and we have found two exactly very quickly when we were working on this stuff. So we saw the account guessing plus brute force. We saw that also there is some authentication bypasses, just like looking in Google. There could be also SQL injection, but we didn't test it, LFI, and so on. And for an example, I will speak about a product that we've been testing lately. It's a 3G intercom. It's provided also with an M2M SIM card. And we'll call it product A, just to anonymize the product. So product A website doesn't enforce a password to manage it. So you just have to put a number, the number of the intercom that is also provided in the manual. So the only way to manage this intercom is just to put the number of the intercom and you can manage it after. But as an attacker, we need a valid number. We don't know any number. Okay. There is a solution. You're doing a quick poke like that, that will generate all numbers, and test all numbers in the web page. And as you have also error code, you can use the, that error code error page to collect every valid numbers. And that's, you know, a very quick way, but you know, that worked because we, for one prefix, in less than 4 hours, we were able to collect like 90 numbers, valid numbers, and to also log in this in the managing platform with that numbers. And as you can see, here is the platform that enable you to add numbers of the residents, modify the, some commands, some setups, and so on. And that without the need of any SDR tool. Isn't that crazy? So without the need of any SDR tool, you can update all intercom with pre-memorized numbers, and after that, wait for in your Allopass account to get you know your money. But also you can open the doors. The main problem with that is that you need the location of the intercom you want to open. But that's not a problem for some intercoms because in general, people put their home number at the first line of the list. So you can use that and use also reverse lookup directories to take the address and after that go to the address, open the door, and hop. Okay, now let's talk about the second attack vector, which is the attack made with the SIM card, the USIM card. So normally, I'm just asking for myself. Okay, I will take the SIM card, put it in a phone, do tethering, and scan the network. But in this product A, the USIM card has a PIN code. So how to do it? Maybe I can use the SIM trace to act as a proxy between the SIM and the intercom, and let the intercom typing the PIN for me, and like that I can retrieve the PIN code, and with that I can put now the SIM card in the phone, change the image just to be stealthy, and after that set up the right APN to go to the network, the virtual network of the intercom, tether the communication to use my computer. After that, do a trace route and check if I can have the internet or can reach any server in the virtual network. And after that, as an attacker, we are not able to scan the network, search for vulnerable services, exploit vulnerable services, and so on, or just use the SIM card to get a free connection and just do that. So the security recommendation for the M2M solution is to enforce a PIN code for the SIM card and USIM card, like the product A, whitelist the MAEs, pen test regularly the management website, which can have a lot of vulnerabilities because this is very important. Restrict action and request on APNs because for each APN you can restrict the internet connection and so on. I was very, very curious also if anyone knows the answer. Is it possible to firewall the virtual network that come with the M2M solution? I don't know actually. So if someone knows that, please maybe tell me. Audit the virtual network, monitor and block your SIM card and so on. So that are the commentation. The conclusion is that the GSM intercoms are vulnerable to the same flaw as the mobile phone. And my talk, is speaking about intercoms, but there's a lot of IT stuff that use this kind of technology, that kind of technique to communicate. So it is not restricted only in intercoms. As we saw, the M2M intercoms introduce a new vector attack that is much destructive because you can do it for no one intercom in the same time, but more intercom in the same time. And also, we are working and we are finishing the semi-automatic downgrade attack from GSM to from UMTS to GSM, and we will release it in GitHub soon. Thank you for your time, and if you have any question, I'm open for the question.
Okay, thank you. We have a question.
Yes, hi. Did you notice that there's also a way to steal the to clone the card online?
Online, you want to steal that kind of cards online?
Yes, because
from intercoms.
Yes, because when you can send data to the baseband.
Yeah.
The baseband, usually all basebands have AT commands that give you the authentication tokens. Mm-hmm. So basically, when the thing connects to your network, you can steal the authentication code tokens from the card and use them to connect to the real network, basically. So
actually, I don't know. I have to search on that. But because this research is not finished, because we see a lot of things going on, and it is, as you can see, there's no end for that. So yeah. We'll be working on that that thing, so too.
Okay, more questions? Over
there? Yep. Which one?
Just one more. Thank you. Thanks.
Okay.
Anybody else want to take pictures of slides?
No, I don't need pictures. Thanks for the presentation. I just have a very obvious question. Don't want to be like sexual crusher, but what about the legal implications of like jamming networks in the wild, doing downgrade attacks? I mean, you're not just, you know, theoretically just impacting the target, and you have a contract with your customer to, you know, pen test their building, but you're also impacting other people around. So how do you deal with that? No, as a company.
Yeah. No, normally, what we do is to. I was saying that we use a strong signal, but normally, what we do is to restrain the gain, and to very low gain, and we just putting the antenna very close to the intercom to be sure that it will not, you know, break anything close. So. That's what we're doing. So what we're doing is to be very close to the intercom, and we can configure the gain in the Yeti BTS and also in the Open BTS. You can restrict not downgrade, but you can use a very low gain to not send, you know, too much power on it. Is that your question? Yeah. Okay. Thanks. Yeah, it's illegal. Yeah. So, repeat. Can you repeat? Because the jamming is illegal. Yeah.
More questions? No more questions. Okay. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.